Thank you so much for joining us at Lighthouse Baptist Church. In this evening's service, we hope you'll be encouraged through the music and challenged through the preaching. But most importantly, we want God to be magnified in our worship tonight. If you're new at Lighthouse, thank you for being here. We invite you to stop by the Welcome Center after the service to receive a special gift. If you're out in the lobby, it's time to come on in as we'll get started with our service in just a moment. Thanks again for being with us this evening.
Hey everybody, welcome to our service tonight. Take your song books, let's sing together. Song number 146. Stand with me if you will and sing Angels from the Realms of Glory. Come and worship. Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
On that second verse,
shepherds in the field abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with man is now residing, yonder shines the infant light. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
On that third verse,
say,
singing to start our service. Let's pray and then we'll enjoy. Hope you'll plan to be back to next Sunday morning for our Glad Tidings Christmas celebration. One of the songs that you'll hear tonight from the choir is one of the ones that we'll be doing next week. And so we'll enjoy that in just a minute. Let's pray and ask the Lord to bless our service. Father, we thank you for the wonderful day that we've had in your house as we have come to worship you. And as we look at you as that newborn King born in a manger so long ago, Father, let us see you as that great desire of nations, the one we want, the one we long for, God with us. Father, I pray that you'd speak to us in this service tonight. We would look to you as our light in our life, and that God, that you'd please be honored and glorified by all that we say and do. And we ask this in your name. Amen. Be seated and enjoy this song by the choir.
In majesty you came for the world to see. Angels sang of the baby King who was born this day. And oh, what a beautiful love heaven gave. are here with us.
Amen. Take your songbooks one more time and let's sing about that light of the world. Song number 142, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let's stand together and sing it out on that first verse. Lift up your voice.
O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie above thy deep and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light.
Third verse.
How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his hand. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in.
When we sing that last verse, turn around and greet someone tonight and welcome them to the service.
Do you find your places? Let's sing that last one. Oh, holy child of Bethlehem.
Oh, holy child of Bethlehem. Descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel.
And wonderful singing. Go ahead and be seated if you would. Ushers, you too. A little bit of an echo up here if we can dial that in. And good to see Yolanda here tonight. Her first time back in a while with her surgery, and so we're glad to see you. And a huge week this week. Make sure you look inside your bulletin and just look at the calendar for the rest of the month and a lot of Christmas activities. We've got, of course, this Thursday night, our LBA Christmas play, and that'll be, what time is that? I didn't read it in here. 7 o'clock, right here in the auditorium, and it will absolutely be packed, so get here early. It is one of the best run children's type plays I've ever seen or been a part of, and Mrs. Crumley and her team work so hard at it, and the kids have been practicing, and it will absolutely put you in the Christmas spirit. We'll touch your heart, and it'll be a wonderful thing. And then don't forget this Sunday morning, as Brother Jason mentioned, our Glad Tidings Christmas celebration, our choir and orchestra will be having a few extra songs on the Sunday morning service. We'll condense some other areas, and I'll preach a Christmas message, and we'll have a great day next Sunday morning. And then you can see the different other activities on Christmas Eve and New Year's Eve, both of those days back to back. We're going to move our Wednesday service to Tuesday night and have our midweek service on Christmas Eve, and we'll have on that night, we'll observe the Lord's Supper together as a church. We'll have our candlelight part of the service, and so that'll be a lot of fun. And we're going high tech this year. We've actually got candles that you can just turn the switch on that are battery operated, so we're not in danger of burning down the auditorium this year like we have the last 5 or 6 years. We've had to make sure we took special precautions, but that'll be fun that night. And then New Year's Eve, we're still working out what we're going to do. We're not going to have a watch night service. We know for sure we're not going till midnight. We stopped that 2 or 3 years ago when my bedtime got a little earlier than that. And I tried passing it off to Andrew, and about 10 o'clock I said, okay, Andrew, from 10 to midnight is yours. And he kind of rebelled against that too. So I'm going to have to pass it off to Ben, I guess. But we'll have, I think what we're going to do is have some kind of food that night, and have just a short service, maybe an hour, a little over an hour, but eat together, maybe some testimonies, sing, kind of maybe some funny things to recap the year, but that'll all be that New Year's Eve, and we'll get you home before the crazies come out later that night, and so we'll have a good time there, and so be aware of all that. One of the neat things that has happened in our ministry the last couple of years has been our relationship with the Great Light Baptist Church in Seoul, Korea, and the Great Light Christian School. And we had probably 3 years ago, Brother James, we started talking about the possibility of hosting some exchange students from a very like-minded church. Pastor Chun is just an outstanding preacher and pastor, and he's preached here before. We've heard him preach this last year. And in Korea, Christian schools are a new thing. They're not widespread. They're not common. And so Pastor Chun is a pioneer in that area, and they have just a dynamic church and a dynamic Christian school. And it's very important to them that 1 year of their children's schooling is able to be done in America, and they want it to be in a church, a like-minded church and a like-minded school. And so two and a half years ago, we received our first exchange students, and it was such a wonderful experience. My wife and I, our family hosted the pastor's son, who was the same age as Daniel, and that was such a great experience for us, and we enjoyed it so, and make lifelong friends doing it, and all the other families had a great experience. We trust and have heard feedback that it was mutual. It was a good experience for the kids that were here, and they were able to go back to their church and school and just help in so many areas there. And then this year, last January, we received a larger group, almost double the first group, and they've been with us now for about 11 months, and this will be their last service today. They're going to be going home on tomorrow, and in January, we'll receive another group of students, and so we'll have another group to get to know and to love and to assimilate and embrace into the life of our church. And talk to any of the families that have kept a student. It is a neat experience, and if you'd like to participate in that, you can see Brother James. But Brother James, if you'll come, the Benjamin Song is here. He is their assistant principal of the Great Light Christian School. Benjamin, would you come too? And he is here to help escort all the kids home. And I wanted you to hear a word from him. And I wanted us to express as a church our feelings toward their church, our admiration and respect and love, and wanted him to be able to hear from us that, but I also wanted us to hear from him. And we'll miss the kids. At the end of the service, don't let me forget, I want to have all the Korean students come to the front with Brother Song and Brother James. And then when we dismiss, I want all of us to come by and shake their hands and wish them well and greet them in that way. And they had a big gathering Friday night. I think all the host families got together, and they had a meal and had a party over at Mrs. Garrett's house. And a lot of tears were shed. And I know Monday a lot of tears will be shed as folks go out to the airport to see them off. But Brother Song, we sure love you at your church. Pastor Chun, Brother John, and come and greet our church. And then Brother James is going to pray for the offering. And so God bless you. Thank you very much for being.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. 미국에 오면서 이미그레이션에서 굉장히 떨렸는데 여기는 더 떨리네요.
Yeah, when I first got to the United States going through immigration process, I was very antsy about it, but I feel more nervous now than the immigration center.
우선 우리 학생들을 이렇게 1년 동안 잘 섬겨 주시고 보살펴 주셔서 감사의 말씀을 전해 드립니다.
First of all, I just want to say a big thank you from my heart for taking such great care of our students for the past one year.
그리고 이런 유학 프로그램을 흔쾌히 허락해 주신 우리 툴 목사님께도 감사드립니다.
And especially thank you Pastor Tool for giving us this opportunity that we have to co-labor in Christ in training the next generation.
텍사스의 캐슬베리 침례교회 포스터 선교사님을 빼놓고는 큰빛 성서 침례교회를 말할 수가 없습니다.
We cannot talk about the Great Light Bible Baptist Church in Korea without mentioning Brother Ike Foster from Texas.
저에게 그래서 포스터 선교사님은 생명의 은인과도 같습니다.
So the American missionary that I've come to Korea to help our church get started, we cannot talk about our church without talking about the sacrifice that they made.
이제 큰빛 우리 큰빛 크리스천 스쿨에서는 여기 라이트하우스 성서 침례교회와 툴 목사님을 빼놓고는 말을 할 수가 없습니다.
Just like how we cannot talk about the church without mentioning Brother Foster, who had such an impact, we cannot talk about the Great Light Christian School without talking about Lighthouse Baptist Church and the Academy here.
나중에 우리 학생들이 커서 여러분들을 은인으로 생각하고 살 거라고 믿습니다.
And I trust that all of these students who have come through, as they grow up, they will be eternally grateful for all the sacrifice and the love that you have shown to their students.
지금 시대에는 우리 가족만 돌보기도 쉽지 않은 시대인데 이렇게 흔쾌히 우리 학생들을 가족으로서 사랑으로 섬겨주셔서 감사합니다.
In a world that it is just busy enough to take care of my own family, thank you so much, host families, to opening your home to a complete stranger but loving on them and taking such great care of them.
학생들과 돌아가서 한국에서 학생들이 성장하면서 정말 믿음의 간증들이 여기 라이트하우스 성서 침례교회에 전해질 수 있도록 최선을 다하겠습니다.
And we will do our very best on our part in Korea in training these students that now we have them back in order to have a great testimony for the Lord. And we are so grateful for the opportunity to work with you.
여러분께서 기억하시고 계속 기도해 주시고 다음에 올 우리 학생들을 위해서도 또 많은 섬김을 부탁드립니다.
And thank you. Please continue to pray for these students as they go back. And also pray for the students that are incoming in. And we trust that it'll be a great experience also. We thank you.
마지막으로 장소에 상관없이 우리를 사랑하시고 만나게 해주신 하나님께 감사드립니다.
And last of all, I just want to say thank you, Lord. And we want to give all the praise and glory for him. No matter where in the region on earth we live, we can still praise the same Lord and worship him in spirit.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's pray for the offering tonight. Father, we thank you so much for our church and Lord, thank you so much for being a wonderful God, and especially this season of Christmas to celebrate your birth and what you've done for us. Lord, I pray that you would keep our hearts tender, and may it be a great opportunity for us to share the gospel even more. And Lord, we thank you for this service tonight. Lord, I pray that you'll meet with us, may you be glorified in everything that we do, especially be with Pastor as he comes and preaches tonight. Lord, I pray that you'll give him unction. Thank you so much for the church family that are grateful to you, that as we give tonight, Lord, I pray that you would bless the gift and the giver also. Use it for the furtherance of your gospel kingdom. We love you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bibles tonight and turn to Malachi. We're going to finish chapter 3 tonight, and then next Sunday night we'll be in chapter 4, finish that, and then we'll get into some holiday Christmas messages through there. In fact, we're going to look in the book of Matthew before we get to Malachi. We're tonight reminded how far away from the Lord the Jewish leaders were in Malachi's day. And it only got worse. There's a 400-year gap between the end of the book of Malachi, kind of a dead, quiet space in history as far as the Bible is concerned, and then to the beginning of the Gospels and the birth of the Savior. And we're reminded their thinking wasn't right. They weren't thinking about the Lord correctly. Their hearts were not in the right place as a result of that, and their speech was exposing their poor spiritual health. I mean, every time they said something, it was completely opposite of what God intended or what God said. And the thing is, our speech always tells the true story about what's going on in our heart. Sooner or later, what's in us is going to come out in our speech. I'm reminded in Matthew 26 and verse 73, if you'll turn there to begin with, when Peter had denied the Lord, was denying the Lord, in the midst of that, one of the maids came and said, "You're one of them." And of course, he denied and cursed. But look what she said in verse 73, "And after a while came unto him they that stood by and said to Peter, 'Surely thou also art one of them.'" And then look what she said, "For thy speech bewrayeth thee." And that just simply means it betrays you. Your speech is telling us that you're one of them. Your speech is giving you away that you're one of them. And what she was saying is, you talk just like Jesus does and those other disciples do that were all from the same region there in Galilee. And I got to thinking about that. You know, as a believers, people shouldn't have to listen to our speech long before they realize there's something different about them. There's something different about that teenager. There's something different about that man or that woman or that believer. In our day, finding anyone who isn't cussing or isn't just overly critical, or finding someone that speaks kindly and politely to others stands out. I mean, not the rule, generally speaking, and so that's the exception. That's why, as believers, as we're doing business around town, as we're frequenting restaurants and just paying for things at registers and interacting with people, just doing our business, it's so important that our speech is right all the time. It's important that we don't get angry and harsh with people when they make mistakes. It's important that we exhibit in our speech the love of Christ everywhere we go. And I'm not saying we should insist on things getting done right and being accurate, but we cannot be a poor testimony for Christ. One thing is certain: what is in our hearts will ultimately come out. Look in Matthew at chapter 12 and verse number 34. Matthew 12 and verse 34, Jesus said there, "O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh." Now, it's important to note that these religious leaders that Jesus was speaking about here, he said, you're vipers, you're evil, the evil of your heart is coming out in your speech. These were the descendants of the Jewish religious leaders that we're looking at in the book of Malachi. This is just 400 years later, and Jesus is dealing with the same descendants of the same people, and he's dealing with their speech and the things that they're saying and feeling because their heart wasn't right. And so I want to lay that foundation. Now go to Malachi chapter 1. I want to review up to chapter 3 the things that they were saying. And while you're turning to Malachi chapter 1, I'm going to pray and then we'll get started with the message for tonight. Father, help us tonight. Speak to our hearts. Remind us, Lord, that for our speech to be right, our hearts have to be right. We've got to be thinking right. We need to have to make sure our hearts are in the right place. We're devoted to Thee. And so, Lord, help us. Help us to learn from what we see here in Malachi. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Think of some of the things that they said that we know are obviously are not accurate, and they should have, as God's people, known that they weren't accurate. Look look at Malachi chapter 1 and verse number 2, the first thing they said was that they doubted God's love for them. They said, God, you don't love us. And look what they said. He said, I have loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord, yet I loved Jacob. And we taught on that, what that meant. That went back to Esau getting rejected, his offering being rejected, and so forth. But the big thing there is, they said, wherein hast thou loved us? And as God's people, we can know we're not in a good place spiritually when we doubt God's love for us. By the way, we ought to know we're in a bad place spiritually when we doubt other believers' love for us. And so that's very important. Then look at Malachi 1 verse 13, because they also expressed their weariness in serving him. They were just verbally talking about how wearisome it was to serve the Lord. Now, these were their days full-time Christian workers. I mean, these were men that lived of the temple. They served the Lord in that way. Look what he said in verse 13. Ye said also, behold, what a weariness it is, and ye have snuffed at it, saith the Lord of hosts, and ye brought that which was torn, and the lame, and the sick. Thus ye brought an offering. Should I accept this of your hand, saith the Lord? And so they expressed how weary they were of serving him. And I think sometimes in this day, we kind of can get to that place spiritually where we express how tired we are, not in the work, because we can go through those busy seasons where we get tired and weary, but tired of the work and weary of the work and weary of ministering to people and weary of trying to carry the load and the burden of people and weary of trying to love the people that God loves. And that's the place they were. Then they called those who were doing evil good. Go to Malachi chapter 2 and verse 17 there. He said, ye have wearied the Lord with your words. Yet ye say, wherein have we wearied him? When ye say, everyone that doeth evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delighteth in them, or where is the God of judgment? And so they were just saying these things publicly. They were saying these things in the course of their ministry. They were confusing the people of God and certainly blaspheming the name of God, talking about those that were doing evil were actually good. Then in chapter 3, they even denied robbing God. Look at verse 8, and we all know this verse, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me, but ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. And so we can just simply see how completely far away from the Lord they were. In fact, so far away that they didn't know God's love, didn't sense God's love for them. They were weary of serving him. They were stealing from him. They were not bringing the offering and their sacrifices the way God asked and the way God expected. And even to the point where they were calling those that were doing evil good. And in our message for tonight, they said some other very shocking things about how they viewed serving God. Now, I've been saved for 36 years and have been actively participating, engaged in local church ministry from that very day on, these whole 36 years, in four different churches. The church where I got saved in California was a smaller church. Probably the most it ever got was maybe a couple hundred, 250 in attendance. And that's the church where my wife and her family grew up. That's the church where I got saved. And you know, many great things in eternity happen in churches of all sizes. Hey, God's not impressed by the size of a church. He's impressed by the ministry that goes on and the souls that get saved and the gospel witness that gets proclaimed through the ministry of that church. And so I was active there as just a layman, went off to Bible college and served in a large church, what would be considered now in our terminology a mega church, and was involved there, just active as a layman, working in bus ministry and leading bus ministries, and just was involved there. And then went back to California for 8 years as an assistant pastor and filled whatever role the church needed and had a varied experience, learned a lot, grew a lot, was helped a lot. And that's how God led us here 19 years ago. But I say all that to say this, serving the Lord in any capacity has never been a thing that I've talked about being weary of or not wanting to be involved in. But tonight, look at Malachi chapter 3 and verse 13. He said there, "Your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord." And I think any time we're critical, I think any time we're poor-mouthing serving the Lord and ministry in general, I think all of that God takes offense to from His children. I think that's strong words. He said, "You've been stout against me." They said, yet ye say, "What have we spoken so much against thee?" And the Lord answered them. He said, "Ye have said, it is vain to serve God." It is vain to serve the Lord. That word vain means it's empty or of no value. And so they got to a place in their life where even though that was their calling, even though they were the priests and the leaders, they got to the place where we see no value in what we're doing. There's no it's empty and of absolutely no value to serve the Lord. And they were saying that, and that was what was in their heart. And man, that's a dangerous place to live. That's not a good place to live. You know, the most miserable people in the world are believers who are kind of caught in the middle. They're not on fire. They're not sold out. They're not engaged. They're not invested. They're not involved in the work of ministry, but they're still saved, so they can't go too far because God's chastening may come into their life. They're just miserable. They're not enjoying the blessings of God, and yet they're saved, so they're not fully enjoying all of that the world has to offer. And they're just their mindset is it's vain, it's empty to serve the Lord. You know, anything we do in Jesus' name and for His work has value. And by the way, He will reward those who serve Him, maybe not always in this life, but certainly in eternity. In fact, look at Luke chapter 6 and verse 35. We'll show that verse on the screen. Jesus said there, "But love ye your enemies and do good." Hey, what's so hard about the Christian life? Just do good. Just be a blessing to somebody. Just help somebody. Just encourage somebody. He said, "Do good and lend, hoping for nothing again." I was blessed this morning. One of our adult classes took up an offering, and for one of our men, Brother Newell, was in a motorcycle accident, and he's been out of work and laid up, and the Newells are very faithful members here, and their Sunday school class took up an offering to give to him, just to try to help in this interim. You know what that is? That's serving the Lord. That's doing good. That's trying to be a help. That's trying to be a blessing. That's not looking for any reward or looking for any benefit for themselves. That's just trying to serve the Lord. He said, "And lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great." The problem with the Jewish leaders in Malachi's day is that they were looking for immediate, tangible reward for serving God. And when they didn't experience it the way they expected it or the way they wanted it, they became disillusioned. They became disenchanted with this thing of serving God, almost like they were keeping track. Okay, Lord, we're doing this for you. What are you going to do for me? And when it didn't materialize in the way they wanted it to, they said, this is vain. It's empty. You know, too often we want to see immediate, tangible rewards for everything we do for the Lord. And by the way, we get to see a lot. We get to experience a lot. We benefit a lot. We get to see people saved. Brother Caleb was telling me about a bus kid Wednesday night that came for the very first time, a little 11-year-old boy, and went to Brother Nathan Schaefer's class, and Nathan, in teaching the lesson, was talking about some of the kids listening so that if there's somebody here for the first time, they don't miss hearing the gospel and miss heaven and are in danger of spending eternity in hell. And that little boy's ears perked up, man. His first time he'd ever been in church, first time he'd ever heard the gospel, and so much so that he began to weep and asked Brother Schaefer, hey, tell me about this. I've never heard this before. And Brother Schaefer took the time and told him about salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that little boy trusted Christ as his Savior. And then in tears afterward, I think his Brother Terry, some of the other leaders were saying, hey, what's the matter? And Brother Nathan, treating you okay? Oh, yeah, I got saved. But he said, I just want someone to tell my sister what they just told me. Hey, I want to tell you something. That's reward in heaven for everyone that drove a bus, everyone that teaches a class, everyone that gives generously and faithfully so that we can run the buses, anyone that's ever prayed for our bus ministry. Hey, those are the kind of rewards that in heaven one day we'll realize. Can you imagine for an eternity standing next to that little 11-year-old boy that just got saved on Wednesday night? Hey, that's reward. That makes serving God worth it. There's value in that. And yet when we get disillusioned, when we get away from God, we can't even see that. It's like, Lord, I want something tangible, almost like I want my paycheck, Lord, for doing you a favor, for driving a bus, or for teaching a class, or for singing in the choir. And I want to tell you something, ministry's not about that. Ministry doesn't work that way. There are lots of benefits from serving him, but many of our rewards, we're going to have to be patient until we get to heaven. I've been around some disillusioned preachers through the years. I've been around some disillusioned full-time Christian servants through the years. And I want to tell you something. They're some of the most unpleasant people to be around. I mean, they don't have no joy. They're not excited about anything, about the things of God or anything. And many who've gotten completely out of ministry because they did not see the value in serving God. And I want to remind us tonight that serving him, much of the value comes from serving him, is eternal in nature. Much of it will never be realized here on this earth, but understand, God won't forget any deed or ministry done in his name. Take your Bibles and turn to Hebrews. Turn to Hebrews chapter 6. And look at verse 10, Hebrews chapter 6, and look at verse 10. The Bible says, therefore, God is not unrighteous. Now, that could go unsaid, but God thinks it's important to remind us, God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. By the way, he would be unrighteous if he forgot. He would be unrighteous if he didn't keep impeccable, perfect record keeping on the ministry of his children. He's not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have showed toward his name. I want to make sure we understand it has to be ministry that's showed toward His name. He's not going to necessarily reward ministry that's made to build up our name or to push us toward the front, but any ministry we do in His name, when we bring a cup of cold water in His name, He will reward that and He will bless that. Look what He said, in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. I love that because there's two tenses there. He says He's not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love that ye have showed toward His name, in that ye have ministered in the past. You've been ministering. You have ministered. And yet, then He says, and do minister. That's talking about in the present and on into the future. In other words, He said, look, folks, you've got a great track record of ministering. You just have to keep it up and continue to minister now and into the future. And the Bible's very clear. He will not forget that work and labor of love. He keeps perfect record and will always reward His children accordingly. Nothing that has ever been done in ministry in the right spirit and with the right motives is in vain. There will be tangible rewards in heaven that we won't receive to put on our mantle place. That's not what it's about, but we'll have those rewards to cast at the Savior's feet. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. He said there, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, and I like this next phrase, the righteous judge shall give me at that day. You know, it doesn't do us any good to try to keep track of what so-and-so's doing or how much they're doing or if they're doing as much as I am or we are. That's not what it's all about. It's about me doing what the Lord is calling me to do. It's about me being engaged, following His leadership in my life and me leaving the rest of it up to Him, because He is the righteous judge, and at that day He will reward everyone according to their work. But then they said something else shocking. Go back to Malachi chapter 3. They said it's vain to serve the Lord. And I'll tell you what, I've not heard any preacher say that in their disillusionment, but I've heard them say everything but that. I've heard them say, man, I'm gonna go do something else. I'm not gonna spend one more day in ministry. I'm gonna go do something else. But here's what they said next. They said they saw no benefit in obeying Him. So they said it's vain, it's emptiness, there's no value in serving Him. And then they said, and we're not receiving any benefit, we're not receiving any profit when we obey Him. Almost like, Lord, we'll obey You, what are You going to give me? Lord, we'll do what You've asked us, but what do we get in return? And that's a completely wrong way to approach the Lord and ministry. Look what He said in verse 14. He said, it is vain to serve God, and what profit is it that we have kept His ordinance? They didn't see how it profited them to obey. They wanted to be rewarded for simple obedience. You know, sometimes we act like what He asks us to do is unreasonable. And we forget the proper perspective. We forget that He's the Creator. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's our Savior. He's our Heavenly Father. And we're the creature. We're the creation. We're the children. We're the ministers. And so we need to approach it that way. Look what He said in 1 John 5:3. We'll show it on the screen. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. We keep His commandments from a heart of love. We keep His commandments because we love Him, and we keep His commandments because we're thankful that He loves us. For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. It's not asking too much for God to expect His children to do some certain things, obey some certain things. Obedience is the very first thing we teach our children. I mean, it's that basic. The first verse, Ephesians 6:1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. It's the right thing to do. And if it's right for our earthly children to obey their earthly parents, it's right for God's children to obey their heavenly Father. It's just the right thing to do. It's not a grievous thing. We're not doing it for what we can get out of it. We're just obeying Him because it's right. That's it. We obey because it's right. Trust and obey, the great song says. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And what an important thing that is. But our primary motive for obedience is to show our love for Him. I like John 14:15. I'm going to skip a few for guys up there just for sake of time. John 14:15, the Bible says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And so we obey Him, not to get something from Him, though the natural byproduct of obedient children is for mom and dad to want to do something, to want to be a blessing to them, but they weren't looking through spiritual eyes. They just couldn't see it. They couldn't see the blessings that God was giving to them. They couldn't see the value in serving the Lord. They couldn't see the benefit from obeying the Lord. And because of that, they said this. Look back at verse 14 again. The Bible says there, and that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts. In other words, they went about their duties, they went about their priestly responsibilities with a downcast countenance, with a feeling sorry for themselves spirit, with a woe is me, everybody's against me, I just think I'll go out back and eat worms, amen? I just don't think there's any value in serving the Lord. And so it affected their body language. It affected their facial expression. It affected the spirit with which they approached ministry. And it can't help but, if we're so far away from the Lord that we don't see the spiritual value in serving Him, we don't see the fact that that one soul, the Bible says, what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Nothing is more valuable than one soul. And when one soul gets saved, the Bible says there's joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. But when we're so far away from God spiritually that we cannot see the value in one little boy or girl getting saved, or one family getting encouraged and put back together, and one person following Christ closer because of our ministry, boy, we're in bad shape when we can't see the spiritual profit and benefit from obeying the Lord. It's a wonder we mope around. It's a wonder we frown and we're sour and we're mournful, the Bible says here. I like the difference, the psalmist, the difference in his approach, because they had no joy. Their serving for them was drudgery, but there's a huge difference in the way the psalmist approached serving God. Because, see, the psalmist was closer to the Lord in his heart. The psalmist had a relationship with the Lord in his heart. I love what he said in Psalm 100 and verse 2. He couldn't wait to get, Jewish religious leaders couldn't wait to get done with their service. The psalmist couldn't wait to get started. And there's a big difference there. If you're don't see the value in ministry, yeah, you can't wait for this Sunday school class to get done. I can't wait for this to get over, this VBS, Vacation Bible School, to get done. But if you're like the psalmist and your heart is passionately pursuing that relationship with Christ, you can't wait for it to get started. Look what he said in Psalm 100, verse 2. He said, serve the Lord with gladness and come before His presence with singing. That's completely the opposite of walking mournfully before Him. Boy, don't come on the property and come into the services all downcast. And I'm convinced some folks just want people to ask, hey, what's the matter? And by the way, we are concerned and we want to pray. But boy, let's be spiritual about it. And let's not, you can't fake God out. Man, if you've got burdens, go to Him and get some help from others. But our general state of mind ought to be, we're ready to serve the Lord with gladness and we're coming before Him with singing. When we're spiritually healthy, that ought to be our natural attitude of service. We'll be with joy in our hearts. We'll see the value in serving Him. We'll see that it's a privilege, not a burden. We'll have anticipation about what the Lord has in store for us today. Going to the church house will be associated with happiness and joy, not mourning and drudgery. I like what the psalmist said in Psalm 122 and verse 1. He said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Can you sense the anticipation in his heart? That's so different than many believers in our day that try to do anything they can to justify not having to go. But the psalmist said, man, I can't wait to get there. I was thrilled when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. You know, for these 36 years I've been saved and serving the Lord, no one has ever had to drag me to church kicking and screaming. You ever heard preachers, and I've used this, it's funny to say that when I was young, I had a drug problem. My parents had to drag me to church. Parents drug me. Just give me a courtesy laugh. My parents drugged me to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. You know what? I don't want that to be our children's experience. I don't want them to associate church with getting dragged against their will to church. It's good for you, take your medicine. I want them to associate going to church with joyfulness and friendships and blessing and happiness and good time. I want them to be glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. By the way, I think kids are in a good spiritual shape when they look forward to going to Sunday school and they look forward to getting involved in the youth group and they look forward to getting involved in the things of God through the local church. I've been glad for every chance to go. We've always wanted our children's entire church life experience to be one of joy and gladness. We want our entire ministry to reflect that same joy and gladness to our children. We've never wanted our children to run from full-time Christian service. Now, God doesn't call every one of our kids into ministry, but we don't want them to be resistant when He does because their dad was a pastor. Because it was such a bad experience and it was just such drudgery. Well, we've never tried to model that. Certainly, there are challenges in every ministry, in every line of work, in every profession, but we haven't wanted them to run from that. We wanted them to see the benefits of serving the Lord. We've wanted them to see the blessings of serving the Lord. We never focused on the difficulties. We chose to focus on the blessings, and we've wanted them to associate that. Boy, Sunday is the day of the week that we've enjoyed the most. We look forward to. I like what the psalmist said in Psalm 84 and verse 10. He said, for a day. He said, one day. He's putting things in perspective for us. He said, for a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. That'll put it in perspective. One day at church is better than a thousand days anywhere else you could be. One day at church is better than a thousand days in the deer stand. It's better than a thousand days at the ball field or at the racetrack or at the shop. Wherever it is, one day in thy courts is better than a thousand. He said, I had rather Again, that's priority. That's putting it in perspective. I had rather than any of these other things, I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord. Man, just let me open the door for people. It was a little bit different what he's talking about in that day. There were a little more duties and responsibilities involved. Just let me hand out a bulletin at the door. Just let me put the kickstand down and open the door at the end of the service. I'd rather do that than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. What a wonderful thing. I love the idea of rather, because to me it means choosing. It means I'm choosing this over that. It means I'm choosing to go to church other than all these other options. It means I'm choosing to serve the Lord other than all these other options. I love the great song that says, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. And the psalmist said, I'd rather keep the door at God's house. I'd rather play that funny instrument that Art does in the orchestra. I'd rather, what do you call it, oboe or whatever it is. I don't know what it is, but it sounds cool and looks cooler, amen? And he's always got to be out on the front. You notice that? Because it's the only place that can hold as long. That instrument's got to go out and anyway, I don't even know. What do you call that thing anyway, Art? Oh, it's a clarinet. It's the weirdest clarinet I've ever seen, but it's a clarinet. And hey, I'd rather do that than to do anything else that I could ever do. I love that because the psalmist said, and by the way, I'd rather have is the right spirit. I'd rather serve the Lord than anything else I could rather do. I'd rather do his will than anything else in the world. And it was bad in Malachi's day. I mean, it was bad. They didn't have the right spirit. They didn't even want to do the work of God. It got to the place where the Lord just said, we're just gonna have a 400-year parenthesis around this, and the scriptures are going to be quiet, and there's not going to be anything, any activity that I'm going to record for all eternity, because the spiritual leaders are so far away from God, it's not even funny. And then I'm going to bring the Messiah that the group sang about. And then I'm going to bring the Savior of the world. And by the way, we just read at the beginning of the message in Matthew how Jesus was dealing 400 years later with the same group, the descendants of the same group, had the same problems and worse, and yet there are some. By the way, look at Malachi 3 and verse 16. We don't have time, but I want to just show you this, because he says there, then they that feared the Lord spake often to one another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. You know, as bad as it had been in Malachi's day, there was still a remnant. There was still a few. There was still a group that still thought it was important to serve the Lord and talk about the Lord and saw value in it. And the Lord saw it and the Lord remembered it. By the way, can I remind you that Bible Christianity will never be the mainstream? We're always going to be kind of a remnant that really believes the Bible and is not trying to integrate culturally, but we're just trying to obey the Lord. And then I like what he said in verse number 17, and we'll close with this, and they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, talking about that remnant who said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. The ones that said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. He said, that remnant, he said, they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts. In that day when I make up my jewels, I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. And he was talking there about that's the stuff that treasure is made of, the jewels. He said, those of you that feel differently, than these religious leaders that are so far away. Those of you that still have some anticipation and some enthusiasm and some joy about the things of God, he said, you are the ones that are the jewels, and you're the ones, I see you, I'll remember you, I'm writing you in a book. And how important that is, and what a wonderful thing that is. Hey, next week, Malachi chapter 4. If you look there, it's just 6 verses, and we'll finish out Malachi, then we'll get on to other things. But let's bow our heads and close our eyes. We're a little bit longer tonight because of the kind of service that we had, and because Brother James Kim took so long in his part of the service. And let's pray together. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Let's stand together, and we're going to have just a brief time of invitation. But moms and dads, if we're going to pass on to our children a passion for the things of God, it's going to have to be intentionally, and it's going to have to be purposefully, and it's not going to be because like the religious leaders in Malachi's day, we walk mournfully when it's time to be engaged in God's work, or we, because we see no value in serving Him. And I've always wanted, 36 years, I've wanted our children to see their mom and their dad serving the Lord actively in whatever ministry we're in, as laymen, as assistant pastors, now as the pastor. I want them to see that there is great value in serving the Lord and great benefit to obeying Him. And of course, none of us do it perfectly, and all of us have room to grow, but that ought to be our desire. Father, help us tonight as we just think about Thee, as we're encouraged, Lord, by the remnant that saw the value, the remnant that wanted to be engaged, the remnant that, Lord, saw the benefit and saw the value. And Lord, may we be of that remnant in this day. And may we pass that passion and pass that joy and pass that gladness to serve Thee down to the next generation. Lord, may they see it modeled in us. May they see it in their Sunday school teachers. May they see it in the choir when they sing. May they see it in the spiritual leaders that You place in their lives every day of the year. Father, would You bless like only You can, and we'll thank You for it in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Brother Jason's going to sing, and as he does, You come, just a verse and a chorus, You come, You come.
Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I praise Thee, Lord, for cleansing me from sin.
Such a gracious Heavenly Father. And Lord, we our hearts desire to serve Thee. We absolutely see the value spiritually, eternally, in every other way of serving You, for serving You. And Father, we see the benefit in obeying You. Father, first of all, just because it's right. You've done so much for us. And secondly, we know You're the righteous judge and that You're not unrighteous to forget our work and labor of love when we minister to Your name. And so, Father, we do it joyfully and gladly and willingly. And Lord, we thank You for Your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Let's watch the announcements real quick, and then I'm going to come back up, and we'll have all of our Korean students come forward. So let's watch the announcements, and then I'll come back up and close the service.
If you trusted Christ today or you have questions, we'd love to talk to you after the service at our Welcome Center. If you're interested in learning about baptism or getting more involved, our staff at the Welcome Center will have the information you need to take your next step today.
We've recently made an upgrade to our Wi-Fi network here on our church campus, and it's given us the ability to open up a guest network. We know that many struggle with poor reception inside our building, so we hope that this change is a big help to you. The guest network will also provide additional ways for you to participate in the services. If you prefer to give tithes and offerings online, you'll now be able to do that during the offering time in the service. We also encourage you to use social media to check in or share a blessing that you received in the service. If you have any questions, feel free to contact John Barnes and he'll be glad to help you out.
Our church bookstore is having a Christmas clearance sale today. All books are marked down to $3 each. You'll find resources on the home, marriage, and personal growth, and more. The bookstore has been moved out into the lobby and will be open before and after each service today. So stop by and stock up on some great Christmas gifts.
As we head into the Christmas season, many of our church members enjoy giving Christmas cards to our church family. In years past, we've utilized a filing system at the Welcome Center to make this more practical. This year, the setup will be even easier. Simply label each card with the family that you're giving it to and place them in the mailbox in the lobby. By the next service date, they'll be sorted by last name and available for pickup at the Welcome Center. Also available for pickup are your 2020 giving envelopes. These boxes of envelopes are grouped by last name on the blue tables in the back of the auditorium. These dated envelopes are a great tool to help plan your giving and stay faithful to the Lord. If you have any questions, please see Mrs. Karen Molinar or email finance@lbctheodore.com.
We invite you to join us this Thursday at 7 p.m. for our children's Christmas play. The students of Lighthouse Baptist Academy have been working very hard preparing for their presentation of a special delivery. This story will be told by some of our high school students and accompanied by music from our band and various choirs. There is no charge for admission, so we invite you to come celebrate the Christmas story at this exciting event for the whole family.
Over 2,000 years ago, a humble birth into the family of a carpenter changed the course of human history forever. The coming of our Savior marked the beginning of a story that is still changing lives today. Be sure to join us next Sunday morning for Glad Tidings, as together we'll celebrate that magnificent birth. Our choir, ensemble, and orchestra have spent many weeks preparing for this service, making this special event a great tool to invite a friend, neighbor, or coworker to join you in church. Join us next Sunday morning at 11 a.m. as we celebrate the majesty of our Savior's birth.
If you're our guest today, thank you again for being here. Please stop by the Welcome Center in the lobby to receive a special gift just for you. Have a great week, and we'll look forward to seeing you back on Wednesday.